This is the fourth devlog for a game I've been working on, built around rocket jumping, and the community-made jump maps of Team Fortress 2. I would suggest you watch the previous devlogs first, as the content they go over will be very helpful for understanding the technical topics covered in this one. For this video, I'll be going deep into the inner technical workings of both the Source engine and my own engine, since the big topic is replays, or playing back recorded gameplay within the game. I noted how important replays would be for this game in the previous devlog, and now that I have my initial implementation of replays, I'm ready to show the work I've done on them. So let's get into that. Before getting into those very technical topics, I'll briefly start off light with the other work I've done, which relates to level design. Jump maps in TF2 frequently use a few specific level elements in Source to create their many unique challenges, and it's important that my game has parity with those most important elements while making out-of-the-box improvements that streamline the new player experience. The two most important level elements that nearly every jump map uses are teleportation triggers, which are typically used to force a failure state, and triggers that delete rockets on impact, which are used to prevent players from jumping off specific walls or floors that would break the intended challenge of the jump. While the latter is very straightforward and not in need of much improvement, the former is what can be improved upon with a standalone game. In the Source engine, every instance of a teleport trigger has a set teleport position entered in the hammer level editor, which cannot be dynamically changed when the map is running in-game. There's no built-in function to reset at the start of a jump, because there is no way to save a position to return to through map logic, so jump maps use teleportation triggers as a workaround. You can get around this limitation by using the getPause and setPause console commands on binds, or server plugins that mimic save state functions, but it's clear that this system is in need of streamlining. This is why I implemented a checkpoint system into my design, which simply saves a position value when a checkpoint trigger is entered, and rather than having the analogous fail state triggers simply teleport the player to a set location depending on which jump they exist on, they will instead teleport the player to the current activated checkpoint. This has the huge benefit of streamlining reset binds, so that with the press of a key, you can instantly return to your previous checkpoint, rather than requiring the use of console commands or server plugins. This is a much-needed improvement that was an unfortunate effect of TF2 being a game built for PvP that doesn't take into account these single-player movement game modes, so it's an obvious change to make when making a game specifically for single-player. There are some other level elements I made, but I'm going to save talking about them in detail for when I've put them into the context of levels, so discussion of those will come in the next devlog. For now, I'd like to get into the real meat of this devlog, which is my implementation of replays. But before getting into my implementation, I need to explain some things about how games in general work. If you know anything about the inner workings of games and game engines, you'll know that video games are displayed by drawing pictures onto your screen very quickly to create the illusion of motion. Each of those pictures is called a frame, and the number of frames the game can draw in 1 second is the frame rate measured in frames per second. Many games, including the first game I released and many games made specifically for consoles, have game logic and physics tied to the frame rate, but it doesn't necessarily have to be this way. Modern engines can use delta time to get the exact time in seconds elapsed since the last frame, and this can be used to make game logic frame rate agnostic, which also allows the game to draw new frames as fast as it can without completely breaking game logic. This approach is not very compatible with replays, however, and to explain why, I need to explain the typical structure of replays and more broadly what the point of a replay system even is. Replays are typically files containing specific data from each frame that the game can read to play back the player's recorded movements. We want to get specific data from the game and read that data inside the game, rather than doing something like recording video footage for a number of reasons, but the most important reason is that storing the data required to play back gameplay inside the game requires much less data to be stored on each frame, which allows lower-end computers to play the game and record replays without frame rate dips, and this also allows replays to be stored and shared more easily, since they'll use less storage space. The issue that you run into when using the previously mentioned delta time method to uncap the frame rate is that reducing the amount of data you need to store in a replay file is all about making assumptions. If you use an uncapped frame rate, you'll have to store the delta time variable for each frame, which is quite inefficient in comparison to a fixed frame rate where you can assume the length of each frame. But the more pressing issue with an uncapped frame rate is for replay playback, because for perfect playback, your computer would need to run the game at the same speed or faster than the replay was recorded at in order to keep up with the speed of the replay. For this reason alone, running the game at an uncapped frame rate won't work well for replays, unless you do whatever Blackmagic Valve performs with CS2's subtick system, which is obviously out of the question for me. Luckily, there's another approach that combines fixed and uncapped frame rates, which is what I'll call a tick system. Essentially, we can have both a fixed physics frame rate measured in ticks and an uncapped visual frame rate, which is what the Source Engine does. TF2 has a fixed tick rate of 66 TPS, and for the purposes of calculating collision and entity movement, time in between those ticks doesn't exist. But rather than characters and projectiles noticeably teleporting around every tick at frame rates higher than 66 FPS, the game will interpolate positions for drawn frames in between ticks. With this solution, you can get the best of both worlds, and it allows for replays to function regardless of the visual frame rate produced by your computer, so long as your computer can run the tick rate at full speed, which takes minimal amounts of computational resources compared to rendering. I'm making my game in Godot, which comes out of the box with what's called a physics frame rate alongside a visual frame rate, though I'll be referring to that physics frame rate through the vernacular of ticks for the purposes of continuity when talking about both engines. There are two potential ways I could set up replays for a game like this, and my first idea was to make a system entirely based on events. In a replay system like this, you would record events only when they happen on a given tick, with events being things like position and view angle changes, or a rocket being fired. This sort of system is ideal for networked games, where you may not get all the information you need every frame, but for a game like mine, there's a more optimized system when it comes to file size, which is to simply save inputs every frame. This system is great because you can essentially feed inputs to your existing player controller to achieve the exact same movements that they would produce in real time, though this comes with some caveats. The big one is that the system is entirely reliant on the game's physics properties never changing, as if you even slightly change any values like jump height, rocket strength, gravity strength, etc., that replay is now at risk of desyncing, or showing movements that didn't happen in the initial recording. Additionally, any sort of random element in physics cannot exist, since that will also cause desyncs. While I'm avoiding including any elements of randomness in player movement, this also means that there cannot be any random level elements either. But for the sake of keeping replay files as small as possible, and the relative convenience of this system, I went ahead with solely input-based replays. I process almost every player input and movement during the tick step, so for keyboard inputs, all that needs to be saved is a series of ones and zeros representing whether or not the corresponding key is pressed on that tick. But there is a type of input which is processed in the frame rate process, which is camera rotation with the mouse. However, I can simply save the rotation at the time of each tick, and since things dependent on view angle, like firing rockets and player movement, are all processed on ticks, as long as the view angle for each tick is correct, the replay will play back correctly. With this implementation, file sizes for replays will take 10 bytes per frame, 2 bytes for the input field, and 8 bytes to store the player's view angle as two floating point numbers. But this is the system without any optimization, and there's one clear flaw that can be improved upon. There will be a lot of recorded frames that have the exact same inputs or view angles as the previous frame, and storing the same data for many frames repeatedly is an inefficiency that's simple to fix. We can pull from the event-based replay structure and only save inputs and view angle when they change, as well as having a frame end event that is placed in the file at the end of every frame. In a worst-case scenario, where input and view angle does change every frame, this is slightly less efficient space-wise at 13 bytes per frame, but in the vast majority of cases, this will result in smaller files because the smallest possible frame is only 1 byte to store the end frame event indicator. If you have any experience with game development and have been paying attention, you may have noticed that I'm storing view angle as two floating point numbers, rather than cumulative mouse movement as two integers, which would greatly reduce the size of the view angle data. I've shelved this potential optimization for now because my several attempts at using this method resulted in persistent desyncs. I think there's something happening with decimal rounding that causes Godot's function which reads mouse movement to be imprecise when converting to integers, though this is admittedly a difficult problem to debug, so that may not be the actual cause. I won't rule out the possibility of this making its way into the game in the future, and there are many things I expect to change as I add more features to the game, but for now, I'm happy with my implementation of replays. But there is another thing you may have noticed, especially if you're familiar with Source Engine movement game modes, which is that I haven't said what the tick rate is in my game. This has been a difficult choice for me, as I initially set the tick rate to 120 for the previous versions, but now I've moved it down to a more conservative 60 for a few reasons. You may have heard of the tick rate debate that was fought in CSGO before CS2 released, where official servers ran a tick rate of 64, while third-party matchmaking services like Faceit ran a tick rate of 128 for the increased precision of player position and aim on the server's end. But when CS2 moved to a subtick system, where every action on the player's end is given a precise timestamp for it to occur, precise movement in competitive games was crippled due to what are called tick-perfect techniques. A perfect bunny hop is tick-perfect because you need to jump on the exact tick that you land to preserve your speed. And since that window is solely based on ticks, that window gets smaller as the tick rate goes higher due to the period of time each tick represents getting shorter. Because of this, movement game modes in CSGO like Surf and B-Hop are typically played on 64 tick for increased consistency over 128 tick, and especially over the inconsistencies of CS2's sub-tick system. So if lower tick rates are better for movement consistency, why was I considering having a higher tick rate? The answer is that I'm trying to design this game so that every would-be tick-perfect technique has either a buffer to make it non-tick-perfect, like my bunny-hopping implementation, or exists along a gradient where being tick-perfect gives you the most speed, but being slightly off gives a similar effect like my speed shot implementation with sliding. This would greatly reduce the inconsistencies caused by tick-perfect techniques at high tick rates, but they wouldn't completely eliminate them. And if any other tick-perfect techniques arise from my engine, they would be made twice as hard to hit compared to a lower tick rate of 60. Another issue is that, since mouse movement is processed during the rendering frames, playing with a 60fps cap will mean you'll miss out on more fine control of your angle when air strafing or surfing, since you'll only be able to change your angle for every other physics frame. Higher tick rates will also require more space to store replays, since more data will need to be stored each second, and by halving the tick rate, that will eventually halve the size of replays, which is a big positive to lowering the tick rate. Because of all these issues with higher tick rates, I've made the choice to move down to 60 TPS, which I figure is much more likely to be a net positive change rather than a net negative. There are lots of important things involving replays that I've begun working on but aren't entirely ready as of yet, like the tutorial system I described in the previous devlog, but here's another use for replays. Much of my implementation of replays has been inspired by Devil Daggers and Hyper Demon, since there are many similarities between those two games and my project. But seeing as how my levels are lacking in random elements, and the goal of the game is to go fast rather than to just survive in a small arena, there's another use for replays that goes beyond just watching them. So inspired by the Ghost system from the Mario Kart series and other racing games, I'm working on a system for racing against a given replay. I already have this simple ghost model set up for viewing replays from a third-person perspective, but in the future, it will be set up so that you can play levels while a replay is running, allowing you to race against that ghost for a visual representation of a time to compete with. But that won't be ready for the time being, and since I've shown all the work I've done for this video, here's what's next for the project. The next devlog will probably take a while, since it's going to have a little bit of everything, but the most important thing will be level design, as I won't be releasing a new devlog until I'm done with at least the initial version of the beginner map. If you want to hear when I'm done working on all that, subscribing to the channel is the best way to do it. That's all I have to show for today, but hopefully I'll have more to show you soon.